I'll present you now a bit what I was doing for my research and what the direction I'm going to. I will focus. So basically, my topic is knowledge acquisition, and but based with focus on the crowdsourcing. First, I will show you a bit of motivation behind this, so why I started with that, and then a bit of introduction to knowledge acquisition. Then I will point out the challenges on all of this. So with the acquisition itself, with the crowdsourcing way of doing acquisition, and at the end of the challenges of the conversational clients, which will be I will be probably using for doing the crowdsourcing acquisition on the knowledge.
So Luca, I have actually a high level question. So far in knowledge acquisition, we didn't use any machine learning.
No.
Right? But is that direction you can go to?
Yeah, this will be.
Are you going to do it?
Yeah, I will point it out. It will be needed. It will be needed at the end where you will have to pick which questions to show users and when to show them, and which questions are most relevant, and which questions are most relevant for the which questions take the most knowledge out of the user.
Okay, so the idea is in PhD we'll have some machine learning to support knowledge.
So we'll have we'll have ontologies, reasoning, machine learning, and like this approach all together.
Okay, good. Yeah, thank you. Mm.
Well, at least I think this now. I'm not sure where.
Yeah. No, we should have. We should.
Why would one need knowledge acquisition? It's because we need knowledge, or computers need knowledge, in order to be able to solve more complex tasks. So especially it's important in everyday situations when computers interact with humans. And for example, no computer yet has the common sense of a six-year-old child. So all that is now is kind of on lower level, and it's very hard to build something manually, which would have enough of knowledge. So that's why it would be nice if it can be done automatically. So, for example, what can it be done if when you have knowledge? So this is taken out of Psyche. It's some system, AI system I'm using a lot, and basically all this what I will be showing today is somehow using it. Not all parts, but usually I end up using this. So basically here I ask the system in English, find the patients with bacteremia after pericardial window, and then the system parsed this sentence, tried to understand it, but it didn't completely, so that's why it proposed the sentences which it find the matches in its logic, and then I manually had to combine them. And then the system was able to answer this complex question. So this wouldn't be able if it wouldn't have knowledge about any knowledge about the what patient is and about the things mentioned in the query. So another example is I was asking it what which truck basically can drive some shipment order. So this is the shipment order, and I was asking which truck can drive the shipment order to the center of the Munich. So this was done on some European project as an example of reasoning, and it took me maybe 3 or 4 days to actually enter all the knowledge inside here that Psyche was able to answer this question. So what it did basically is it answered, so this truck, Mercedes Atego something with this registration plate, and then here is an explanation why this truck can drive the shipment order. It's because on the shipment order were frozen fish, and this truck is limited, and it was weight, I don't know, maybe 4,000 kilograms or something, and this truck is limited to maximum of 5,000, and it can drive stuff which is cooled down, and it found out this is a shipment document, and the maximum temperature of it is -5 degrees, so it found out from the stuff which was on the shipment document, because it was fish. So this is all explained here, and basically this is all the system, the AI system does it all automatically based on the knowledge it has inside. So, but in order to make this work, I had to enter about this truck that it has refrigerator and what's the lowest temperature it can do. I have to tell it about what the fish fillets are and that they are meat, and I have to enter a rule that if something is meat, it needs to be refrigerated when you drive it. So it was quite complicated to do it. So basically, if we could do this kind of knowledge, if we can find this knowledge automatically, it would really make these things easier and faster to do it.
So automatically, Luca would mean also automatically from the shipment document or something?
Yeah, it could be.
Or the database of trucks.
So yeah, this example was actually connected. The idea of this example was that it was connecting to the already existing database in the company, in the truck company. So I have to point him, okay, this column in the database is the trucks, this column is the shipment orders, this column is the items on the shipment order, and so on. And then it basically find out, it took the knowledge from there, it took the instances from there, but the classes, the exact knowledge I had to enter beforehand.
So relationship to from here to, let's say, this PhD topic would be that this kind of problems could be done by collecting information from this social setting, right?
Yeah. So yeah.
Maybe
so,
not for trucks, but similar things.
Yeah. So this can be applied to many domains. So even in this example, basically I didn't show everything, but when I was showing this on this project before, there is a before that. I was opening this the shipment document, and it was listed there what it is on it, and then it was basically asking me what's that, and I had to. So it was a bit of knowledge acquisition already, but still a lot of things had to be done. Yeah. So this was part of the motivation. Another part is what I will be showing demo now. So this is these two are the same application, just two different versions of it. And this is another instance based on the same platform. So basically what this was, we were in Logates, E6 were installing sensors, and they wanted to have, to annotate them a bit. So they wanted to know where they are and where they're mounted on and whether there are trees around. And so I modified this application for just for them. So basically you scan the sensor code, and the sensors were equipped with QR code. We scanned it, and then the system was asking a bit about that sensor. So the idea is that there is a backend which can do the acquisition, and then you can do more versions of it there. So this another thing is application which we are doing together with SciCorp, and is meant, it's a bit like a personal assistant which learns about your world and tries to figure out a lot about you and a lot about stuff you are doing. And later on we will add, so now it's just learning, it does a bit feedback, but we turn off the part where you can ask questions. So basically when we'll have enough of data and users, we'll turn that on, and you could kind of interact with the system in natural language or partially in natural language. And basically machine will be asking questions, and you people can ask questions as well. So I'll show a bit of demo. With this now. I didn't have time to buy the cable, so it will be lagging a bit.
Cable, you mean from?
Yeah, so it's possible to connect phone directly to the laptop, but no. Now it will be a bit slow, but basically how it's here is, you see the conversation. So this is you and this is the cat, and then here you have an options for input. So sometimes you have predefined dialogues, you can just click, and sometimes you can enter free text. Mm. And here is, you can see, because this is a bit social, here you can see the other, what the other users were doing or asking. Here are the points, because each time you answer, you teach it something, it's happy, you earn points. And here you have where we are now and a bit of location history. If you click on this, and this guy makes it find your location if you click it. It does this automatically as well, but if you want to force it, you click on this guy. So basically I will do this now, and I will lie a bit to it that we are in some bar, just to show that what it will ask about it. Yeah, so it's okay. In meantime, I can show the. So, for example, this is what the ten latest answers from other people. So this is some guy who is in New York now. He was playing with it a bit. No, okay. Now it asked me whether we are at the JSI. I will lie to it and say we are in some bar nearby. It's turned off because we had some bugs. But well, now I don't find the bar. But
before,
no. Yeah, I was thinking about Café Mai, which was a bit more empty. It doesn't matter. I will pick this one if I don't find it. Yeah.
Nobody thought anything except egoist.
Yeah, egoist is already we answered all the stuff about egoist already. Maybe this one is more empty.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Okay, so now for this one, it doesn't even know that it's a bar or a cafe. So now I entered that it's a cafe, and then it wasn't sure which kind of cafe I thought. That's why it asked again, and then I selected that it's an organization. And now it wants to know a bit more about it. So it will ask all sorts of questions, but the one I wanted is, it also asks about the visit there. So it will, at some point, it will ask me what I ordered there and with who I am there. So it's kind of learning about it will learn about the menu items they have and the prices. And how we did it is that when you answer something, so some questions are just answered and then it goes on, but for some questions they have follow-ups. When you answer with something, then it because of your answer, it asks you more about the thing, or it start to be more, so it, for example, if you, I will come to this question. Well, okay, so now this question is a bit more interesting. For example, that I ordered something, okay. Yeah, it won't know what is burek, probably. And now
you're
it's...
better, you have opportunity to explain.
Yeah, so when it doesn't know what it is, so this is basically the knowledge acquisition part. It knows that it has to be food or drink, but it doesn't know where exactly in this this ontology to store it. So that's why it asks a bit more. So, but for burek it won't, because it doesn't even recognize anything from the text. But for example, if inside this ontology would be something which would already, so under this tree, if there would be something, some item, which would have somehow the same the same name in it. It would ask whether it's this, or now it will be just, it just ask whether it's food or drink or type of addition. Later on, it will ask more questions about that to define it more.
Can you only select type, or you can enter a new type as well?
You can sometimes you can enter it, so it depends how much it finds. So in this example, not.
But can you define this buddhika?
Yeah, I'll say it's food or drink, but there's a bit an error. It's food or drink. I'll explain this later. So I have direct exact example, not about burek, but about some other thing. So, but what I'm trying to show now it should ask what's the price. Okay, now it inferred that if I order it, it must be on the menu, and it's checking whether this is true, because of the crowdsourcing system we have. When some other people answer something, the other users, it's asking whether this is true, and now itself figured out that if I order it, it's on the menu, and then it's still asking me just in case it was wrong.
If you would say no here, would all this consistency within ontology would collapse?
No, when it has enough of no's, it decides, okay, it's not, it's wrong, and then just deletes the statement which is telling this. Yeah.
What does it mean?
It will.
Enough no's means.
So we didn't define this yet. We didn't. So yeah, this is part of the research or part of the thing we have to figure out.
Wrong question.
So, just
yeah. So now the first thing which will be is threshold. We probably it will, but later on probably we'll have to find some other metrics.
Yeah, we'll see.
To.
I expect there are going to be several kind of decisions we'll have to make, and then decide which of them to open up and which of them are not worth research, because there are many things to figure out.
Yeah,
also,
so
like Lucas now lied to the system. And then maybe you'll come later and say, no, this is a JSI. So there are also these consistencies and so on.
So here, now I clicked on this location part, and it shows me my location history. And for example, I don't know, maybe it knows something about TSM, JSI. You can click on these links as well and somehow navigate for this around it. Yeah, so basically this is what it knows right now about JSI, not much.
The most important things.
We have a bit of ways to navigate, to tell it about what we would like to talk, for example, or to ask me more questions about you and things like that. So this is still very early prototype. So it's each day something is different in it. So this is what it knows about me. And there are some fake facts because a designer who designed this was playing and entering stupid facts about me. So I didn't. Yeah, I don't know what he meant with that.
Expert knowledge about hamburgers.
And we have a bit of things. So right now it's a bit of empty because I just reset the knowledge base a week ago. But we have a bit of things here. Like for example, if I would answer that I like beer, and somebody of my friends likes beer as well, it tells me, oh, this guy likes beer as well. And when you answer with something, when you tell it the price of something in a bar, it tells you the cheapest price of this item in the city you are in. And things like that. So just lately we start to add this kind of smart replies, which are again done inside the knowledge base. So I wanted to show you this, but I don't know how many questions I will have to answer before I'll come to this question. So probably I should continue with the presentation, and then maybe at the end I can show that. So knowledge acquisition, constructing a knowledge base can be quite hard. So that's why knowledge acquisition, for example, psych knowledge base, the knowledge base you were using in this application, they took them more than 25 years to build it, and it's still not on the level everybody wanted to be, it should be. So with knowledge acquisition, it this can be a bit faster if done properly. So here I showed that basically the acquisition can be done before acquisition. There is information retrieval or information extraction, which can be done from more sources or in more ways. So basically before that, we somehow construct a bit smaller bits of knowledge, like triples, or in Curious Cat case, just small short replies. And then we process this to go in the actual knowledge base. This is how it's usually done on the textual approach. So it means that it's scanning documents and it tries to find knowledge in the natural language on the written documents. Usually it's some, so you have corpus and maybe some seed data or maybe some seed knowledge base, small knowledge base which you later extend. And then with some machine learning algorithms, it usually takes pre-processing, extract patterns, and then it does extraction. And sometimes there's a back loop to learn new patterns, to extract even more information. And then it's some sort of assessment whether the knowledge is in any value. And then it goes inside, and you can go another circle and so on. So this is how. Like other authors or other people who does this is somehow common approach. With the crowdsourcing approach, it's a bit different. So usually we have a crowd or users, and then so in our case the system gets user ID and location as well. It's not always like this, and then the system replies with some form which user has to fill, and then it goes on and on. And here inside, it communicates from the API. And in our case, we have a rule engine and ontology and the rules which produces these forms. This is somehow an infrastructure of this. As I said, there are different approaches to knowledge acquisition. It can be separated by prior knowledge. So some you can use pre-existing ontology, or you can just start from scratch. Usually it's easier to use this one because it's more defined, and as well by input. You can do it on structured data, semi-structured, unstructured, or for example, I added crowdsourcing, which is what we are doing. And we are actually using as well pre-existing ontology, which we extend, and crowdsourcing, which we extend to be social, and using conversational clients. Basically, you do the knowledge acquisition while talking to application and doing other things. So some, if done right, you wouldn't even know you are actually teaching it in some cases. So this application I just showed, it's so basically machine can ask human a question. So this is a bit about the interaction. Machine can ask human a question, which human replies. And this blue line is done usually in some sort of natural language generation. So if you use Scikit, it's from inside the ontology, or you need to have some patterns, some written patterns, so somehow the ontology gets converted to something human can understand. And then person can respond with predefined options. As you see before, you can click, you can have OK, yes, no, and some other predefined things. Or so for the future, we will add again as well the knowledge guided input, which would basically be open, but you would only be able to enter stuff which is already here, so which is a bit controlled language. So basically, you could just use the language and concepts knowledge base already knows about. And then the third option is with free text, and then you would have to do some machine learning or some other types of figuring out how to convert it to logic. So another interaction here is that human can ask machine. I didn't show this one because it's disabled now, because we have to focus on the first one for a bit more. And then machine answers, but it can answer based on whatever it knows, but also as well based on the knowledge human taught it. But
so Luca, this second part is not really knowledge acquisition, right?
No, the second part is basically retrieval. Yeah. It's the opposite of.
But it can be if I ask a question and I ask, okay, what is the password of wireless internet here in this room, and the machine answers something, and then I try it and it doesn't work, then it can turn into knowledge acquisition. I say, you know what, it doesn't work.
Mm.
So it can be switching from one to the
other. Yeah, right. It can. Yeah,
the machine can say, okay, if it doesn't work, tell me what is the password.
Yeah, it can do that with. It can jump back to this one, and as well, if it doesn't know the answer, it can forward the answer to humans. For example, in a bar, when you ask something, it doesn't know how to answer. Or if I would ask now whether Egoist, a bar nearby, now is full or not, and it doesn't know because it doesn't have the data, it forwards it to people inside the Egoist because it knows the location. And then these people, this person or somebody there answers my question. And then with this approach, we as well get the questions and answers people are asking. So even if you don't, if machine doesn't have a clue at all about this, we can still get answers, and machine can learn about the stuff people are interested in, and then we can use machine learning to figure out new relations and concepts and stuff and enter it to the knowledge base.
Can I just ask something? You mentioned is the bar full as an example of a question, but that's the sort of fact that whose true value changes with time. Now, at some point it's full, at another
point
it isn't. So how is this fact that some facts change with time, how is this handled?
So this is more question for ontology engineering, but in this case, in the Curious Cat, we use what they use on psych. So basically, we have all the data is in micro theories. So each users can have separate knowledge as well, because some user believes something is true, which other doesn't. So you can separate by users, and this micro theories allows you to separate by time as well. So when you tell a statement, you can define when it's valid and how long it will be valid. And there's many ways to do it. So for example, you could mark questions which are valid only temporarily, or you could ask whether about the how long they will be valid and stuff like that. So we didn't start with this yet, but there's a way how to do it. We were thinking about this already.
Do you know which questions have temporal
relation? For some questions you know. For example, this one, whether bar is full now or not, you know. But I'm not sure how you would know automatically. So for example, in the knowledge base, you could mark the ones which are temporal, and for the ones which you know validity, but for some you don't.
Some relations have this temporal nature.
Yeah. Yeah, for some of them you can say that they are temporal, but for some you can't. One way to noticing this feature of them is if people would be answering all the time different questions on the different answers on the question. So this could be a trigger that something is strange with the answer. And I mean, we will have to find a ways to figure this out. So this is a bit of knowledge acquisition, a bit more of knowledge acquisition. So basically, you have more levels. You can search for instances, classes. So instances is really easy, and many people are doing this. So, and as well, we have covered quite well. Then you can find about new classes and about the hierarchy, which is a bit more tricky because you don't know where to put the new knowledge. Relations is even harder. Also, people are as well trying to do it even with crowdsourcing, but you have lots of problems where to connect this relation into the existing ontology. And rules are very hard, and I didn't even have time yet to check the existing approaches and how we will do it. So this is the example of how we get instances. For example, we have inside the knowledge base relation somebody likes as a friend somebody else, and we tell it that the on this on that these two guys they has to be, so these two arguments has both has to be instances of a person. And when the system asks you a question, here it's done with the pattern, and you, so this is example, and for example you answered with Blaž, then because of these two assertions, because it knows that this should be a person, it already knows, okay, this guy is an instance of person. So this is how we do it here, and this is basically the example. So it asked me who employed me, and I just added somebody, and then and then it was just in case, it was checking whether I was mistaken or it's really an individual. So it, and now it will, he will become instance of. So then another level is classes. So here is an example of ontology of for food and drink. So this example I was showing before, it has food. It goes down to food, drink, and food. It knows about pizza, and drinks knows about coffees and about alcoholic drink, and it only has two types of them. And here is basically the same as before, just that here we say that this is a generalization of food and drink. So it doesn't, it will not figure out, the, it will not, when we'll answer this question, it will know this is a subclass of food and drink, not its instance. It will know that it's a new type of food and drink. It will not try to make it instance. And then, so this is the example I was showing. If I answer it coffee with milk, which is not here yet, it can't know where to put it. It doesn't know that it has to put it here. So it just knows that it has to put it here because of this this assertion. And then
answer.
Well, I'll do it a bit later.
One question. So, since you have psych in the back, why you don't use psych ontology on food?
Yeah, we do.
Why do you have then cappuccino and beer only?
Because I wanted to show an example how it works. Yeah.
That's what in the whole system.
No. It's just I removed all stuff and just This is just an example. Even the names are different in psych, probably. So this is the example of this. This question, what I ordered in Egoist, and I ordered it coffee with milk, and it would put it here by default. So, but we can do it better. So we solve this that it can ask more questions. It can say, because it sees that here is something, and it can ask, okay, is this food or drink? And then it can go down until it finds the right position. And you answer with yes or no until you get it. And then another way is because it has the word coffee in it, and it searches this tree and it sees that there's a coffee, and it asks directly whether this is type of coffee or not. And if you say no, then it goes back and asks for all of them. But if you say yes, it's the direct match.
You could do edit distance comparison for similarity instead of requesting. I don't know how.
Yeah, this could be probably, this could
maybe
be. Yeah, this could be improved. I'm not sure how, but
we can just go on Google and search for pizza and coffee.
Would be better.
Yeah, so how we do it now is search for words, and if there is no, and then we ask, and if it's no or if we don't find words, then it goes down and ask the questions, so it finds the right slot. So it will ask, well, is this a food or drink? And then if you it depends what you will answer, it will say alcoholic or coffee, and then you will find.
But if you don't make it a binary question, if you just give it an option, it's.
Yeah, if you give it an option.
User would select that it's a drink or a food, so it's not.
This can be done this way as well. This would be even better way. But then, okay, option is even better. But if you would just leave the free text, then people could enter nonsense, and then you'd have more troubles finding out the. So it has. Well, later on we could do this, but for now I think it's better that we have it more constrained. Yeah. So and this is the example of these questions. Now it asked me directly whether this is coffee. So for relations, we are not here yet, but so the guys at JSI are doing a research on how to automatically find out the relations and as well the patterns. So Janez and Clement is not here right now, so two guys from JSI are working on this as well, which we'll later include.
So new relations mean new instances of relations or new types?
You are invisible.
So the what do you mean by instances or types of relations?
New links, not relationship, no new instances.
Not new types of,
yeah, like in LOD you would want to enter a new triple basically. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, the
most of, so between two existing entities and existing.
Yes. While adding entities was mentioned before, like new classes or new.
Yeah, new classes were.
Here basically it's new. Triples, yeah.
So the predicates, but the predicates which connect the, but I think it could be done both ways: the predicates connecting classes and the ones connecting instances as well. So, but you have to ask Janez more and Clement how far are they? So I didn't have time to check right now.
So here the idea is, let's say we discussed a little bit. So if in this schema, answering to Blash. going back, I had some discussion with Luca these days. So here the idea was, let's say if LOD or DBpedia, for instance, would be integrated in the rest of the system, which I guess would have sense in many cases. And this is what Clement and Jan and Primoz were doing, was how to suggest that there might be a new triple or some triple might get corrected. But basically, introducing new triple in a probabilistic way, suggesting that there might be a new triple. Like, if Kran is in Slovenia, Ljubljana is in Slovenia, then because of all these similar relationships, such, we can assume also Gorenja Vas is in Slovenia. So this would be kind of triple. So
but
then...
it's easy country relationship.
Would be the same, and the rest of relational structure would suggest that.
And Gorenja Vas would exist already there as well.
Yeah, because somebody else would say, well, I mean Gorenja Vas. And so here with this, we could suggest that there might be this subject predicate object triple there. While here, here we would go way deeper, I guess. We need to discuss this.
So this is the last part of the acquisition rules, which we don't do yet, but I can just, for example, this is the rule which tells the system that when you answer that the wireless in some bar or some place is password protected, then it will ask it for the password. So we do this follow-up questions with the rules. And these things could be done. It would be nice if this could be acquired automatically as well, but it's not easy. We have to finish first parts of the acquisition and then we could focus on the rules as well. So these are a bit of challenges of knowledge acquisition. You don't know where to put existing knowledge and it's hard to get relations and rules and these patterns which generate natural language. So if you want to have a lot of these patterns, it's as well expensive. It's almost similar to building an ontology. So it's still, if as well the patterns could be figured out automatically, it would help a lot as well. So a bit about crowdsourcing. So what we do is that these forums or questions are presented to users based on their context, location, and the previous conversation. And we don't store everything into the main KB, so for everybody to see, but some parts are separated because of different beliefs and of the privacy. But the public answers are showed to other people and then they have to confirm them or deny them. So Curious Cat asks whether this is true or not. And then we remove the ones which are wrong. For now we define. So personal questions. Yeah, so we have the questions which are hooked to concept of you. are private, and not all, mostly it's by the rules. So we do it by hand now. Yeah, so this is example. Somebody else, somebody told it that it has strange coffee on the menu, and then it was asking me whether this is true or not. So this is how we get rid of bad data. So there are some challenges with crowdsourcing. It's like quality and consistency and truth control, as well that different users believe different things. And then another problem is maintaining user involvement. It's hard to make them interesting to actually answer your questions. So we have to find a way, ways to motivate them. So some people do it via games. We try to do it with these points, and with the application will actually return you something useful when it will, you will be able to answer, to ask it as well. And it's important as well how the questions are shown to the user and in what order. Which we have to solve this one yet, so we have to somehow figure out which ones to show and in what order and when and so on. So this will be machine learning, Dunja, when you asked. We will probably have to use this, but you can only do this after we have data. So first we'll have to just throw it to users, and then we could play more with it.
How does the user become more relevant if he has been degraded by wrong answers? Can he has this possibility?
Yeah, so I think maybe even... I thought I wrote this down, but when people are denying, like, proving false some user. So if somebody's answers are always wrong, he will get less important. I mean, not now, but the plan is for the future. We have to add these features.
But can he get them back, his previous status of...
Well, it depends how we'll do it. Probably, yes, it should. I mean, if when he starts to be honest, why not?
Is it based on the ontology, or is it based on everything together? So can somebody become better at knowing which is a good place to have a date all at the same level? Reputation.
So now it's everything is in ontology. But we are combining. So we have this ontology and then a separate system which does caching and the other stuff which we can't do it in ontology. So we have open space to do other recommendation, the recommendation as other systems are doing, or some our own way and stuff like that.
Could somebody be an expert in pizza but not in beer?
What?
So they would trust his pizza related answer.
Yeah, so you could do, yeah, we can do this as well, because it knows what user, the user context, it knows whether somebody is expert in something, it could trust these answers more. But this is a good point, and probably we'll have to do it. But right now we don't have any way to, we just throw the questions to the user, and but we do one thing, when he answers something, and based on this answer he gets more questions, we show these questions questions immediately. For example, if we answer they have a wireless, then it immediately asks whether it's password protected and how fast it is and so on. But for the questions which are not connected, we don't have any metrics yet. Okay, now quickly some about the conversational clients. So I took this from a paper I wrote lately. Basically, I was checking all the Leibniz Prize winners since 1991, and basically how they evolved and what they were using to convince judges in this Turing test. And basically, it's still somehow the same approach as it was in 1966 with ELISA, which was pattern matching. They just added more patterns and a bit like they started to use WordNet and parsers and list of names and so on. Then there was an introduction of AI ML. I will explain a bit later. So this was kind of a bit of breakthrough, because it was possible by normal users, by not expert users, to write chatbots. Because it's XML and you can just easily write patterns. And the strongest thing about this is that it can do recursion. So it can call itself, and this is how it reduces complexity this way. And then there was a totally different approach, which was not they didn't involve patterns, but they had a huge database of people's chats. So basically they took millions of people on conversations and what one person said and another replies, and then they put it into a statistical model, and then based on your question or answer and based on what you say, it tries to find statistically important reply to it. So this one was kind of interesting, and it's actually harder to spot than other ones, but the problem with this one, you can't really control it. It totally depends on the database of old conversations. So you don't have any influence about it. And then some people were just hacking something together, and then one guy who actually was winning for last few years made ChatScript, which is AML. He took everything what was wrong with AIML and corrected. And then this year's winner was actually a guy who was using ontology and AI and reasoning, and he didn't want to use. So he still uses some patterns and responses, but he didn't want to focus on that. He tried to focus that the chat would be smart, not just trying to pretend that it's human, which is kind of right, I think. Because like most of older chatbots were basically trying just to fake it. So lots of pretending, some of them were even faking spelling mistakes and like typing mistakes. They type and then they correct the word and so on. Which was basically, it didn't contribute anything to the research. Maybe for an interesting fact, these guys, Outfit 7 company they are paying this Wilcox guy, and they are using ChatScript for their new version of Talking Tom, or new version of some cat which you will be able to talk with it.
You mean the last one?
This one. Yeah, they were competing here, but they were the second, so they didn't win this year. But so this with Bruce Wilcox, they are he is doing Talking Angela for them. So we don't have time for the example, right?
Leave it for the end. I'm not sure if you will mistake.
Can I just ask something? I'm not completely sure how does this work with conversational clients fit into your problem or your application. So is the idea that if you present the user with a more natural seeming conversation, more easily prepared to answer questions?
Yeah, so the idea is that I will start joining the approach we have now from the ontology. So we will try to join the ontology approach and this scripting approach. So because the ontology is still rigid and you have one way to say things, only one way, so it's a bit boring. So we have to make it more conversational-like. And with combining these two, I think we can improve it. But we'll have to probably to introduce some new chat script which will be more connected to ontologies. So I will just quickly explain AIML. It's really easy. It was like there's a pattern. For example, if you write "I need help" and then whatever, it will just reply "Can you ask for help?" So it's like really a simple script. And the good thing about it is the recursion. So if you say something, whatever, right now, it could forward to itself, and then for example then there is another pattern which was the original statement, "Can you please tell me what Linux is right now?" And this pattern converted to "Can you please tell me what Linux is?" So it basically removed that, and then it called again itself, and then another pattern can take this, and this is how it was easier to cover a lot of replies and responses. And then ChatScript is quite better. So it's after they introduced ChatScript, this was the one who was winning, who always won except this year. And what they do is they have better syntax because no XML stuff. It was easier to edit, and they fixed this asterisk matching, so the AIML can only match one word or more, and it couldn't match zero words. That's what, because of that, it has to have more templates, And then they introduce continuations. So this, when you ask something or answer, then it, based on this question, it gives you replies. And logical variable, logical AND and OR in the patterns and variables as well. And it's, they also have some triple store, which could store facts, which is, it's kind of clumsy, and they have variables, so it remembers some things. So basically, if you introduce variable in some response or reply, it will remember it in this triple store. And they have functions, but I didn't have time, I didn't somehow check what exactly they do with these functions. They called parts of the code or something. So this is example of chat script. Oh, and then they have concept. So here they define concept of meat, which is basically just all the words for meat. It's nothing really complicated or special. And then this is the patterns. So if, for example, if you have sentence, I love concept of meat, then it will reply with this, do you really? And this is the example of continuation. So for example, you say, I like, I don't know how to say this word, spinach. Then it asks you, are you a fan of Popeye cartoons? And then if you reply with yes, it will ask this and so on. So you can do a follow-up conversation with this.
It's pretty much the same as this Eliza from 66. I mean, it was exactly the same.
So that's why Luca said that there was not much. Yeah.
I'm impressed after 40 years.
So they're adding WordNet and synonym lists name lists and so on. So, so the problems with these clients is maintaining the context of the conversation, remembering the facts, and the Chinese room problem. So they're actually, they don't understand what they're talking about. They just, they're scripted replies. So this is somehow what I figure out regarding our approach. So this ontology-driven knowledge acquisition improves precision because of consistency control and controlled entry. And because of crowdsourcing, the bad entries gets removed. And basically, yeah, but the good thing is it can do knowledge acquisition as a side effect of doing something else, whatever your system is doing. But it's a rigid in terms of conversation. It has only one way of saying things, and we don't have a way yet to weight the questions. To know which ones to show in what order and when, so to be more relevant or interesting, and basically the users get what brings the variability is not the conversation or the like in chatbots, because you are surprised what they say, but here you are surprised because they are a bit intelligent. Show par minute, man. So basically, some next steps. So as I said, we'll try to combine chat script, this chat way, chatbots. So this way, the chatbots are doing this with the ontology-driven approach. So this is what I'm working on right now. I didn't solve it yet. And we have to find ways and methods to weight questions and to somehow weight the users as well and so on. So how
to decide what to ask to whom and in which order, so it's kind of engaging the user at the same time getting us information.
Yeah, we could. So it's kind of multi-objective optimization. It has to be interesting for user, and it has to get us as much knowledge as we can. And the goal is as well to connect a lot of user questions and data during the usage of this application. So we'll be actually able to do this these things. So we can't do it without the data.
Okay. So questions. Any further questions or comments?
My comment, I mean, as a follow-up of these discussions last day, so seems to me like, let's see, if we talk about crowdsourcing, basically it's simple, right? And you get simple type of information. Now if you getting knowledge, so structured information, out of crowdsourcing is uneasy or hasn't been done as far as we know. But it's social crowdsourcing in the form of a chat, so this can replace this knowledge acquisition because you engage people in conversations where they, and basically you get them in a context and you motivate them to provide.
So this part when you can go directly through users to users.
Yeah. So this seems to me, I mean, big potential actually, and also quite innovative based compared on this chat bots from Livnet Prize. This is okay. I think we will start way higher already. Mm. I mean, with the objectives. We don't even need to compete with these people. Honestly.
Yeah, no, this will be side effect.
Yeah,
the competing.
It will be side
I would just say that for the user experience part of it, the balance between knowledge acquisition and the more soft qualities that actually make it useful for the user is where it's going to be difficult. You need to get certain kinds of information for knowledge acquisition, but the user wants to know whether it's a good place or not for coffee, which is that soft quality that gets tied to reputation and individual user preferences.
Sure.
So in the old version we already enabled that, but we have, so the plan is, for example, you click here on the cat and then it will start to listen, and then you could ask questions, where is the bar which has wireless and I can read newspaper there, for example, and it actually it's already now, it's able to answer that. We just didn't enable this because it's only able to answer some types of questions. We have to, because it's kind of the opposite of knowledge acquisition, we have to have patterns which will understand natural language and then go to the knowledge, and then the cat will reply. So, but we have plan for that. So basically, as soon as we finish with this first prototype, we have to correct a few more things, and then we will put this back. So we are using Psyche for this. They have some system which already does that, but we'll have to improve it. The idea is that you could ask it anything basically, and if usually it will at least answer the things it knows about, it is asking, but it could on the graph before it forwards them to the users as well. So basically you will always get something.
But one message I guess from your comment was that so friendlier application might engage, might motivate user to provide more often output as well, so.
Right, and me knowing what is the difference between this place or that place in terms of the quality of the coffee will help me use, what will probably encourage me to answer more questions that are specifically about getting knowledge.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So we have to find the ways to somehow for it to be friendly. So right now what we are doing, just so for example when Versus answers something, it says okay, thank you, I just learned that, and if it, based on some rule of it knows something to tell you about it, for example it tells you where is the cheapest coffee in this town and stuff like that. But we'll be adding more of those, but I mean we have to find out which ones will increase the friendliness the most. So right now the one we are actually working on is when you answer, so there is no, this question is not there yet, but just like a few days ago we started to edit, when it's asking about yourself, and for example if you answer that you are a vegetarian, then in the restaurants it will ask you whether it's friendly for vegetarians, but it won't ask other users, for example, because they don't care or they don't know and stuff like that. So, and this is quite easy to do inside here, so we are actually doing that. But it's again, we have to figure out what things and to which level. And
there's a specific rule that you added, for example, if the user says he's a vegetarian.
Your question was more like if this could be done automatically.
Yeah, I was just wondering if there is some sort of larger scale plan on how to do this sort of things.
The way how we discussed looks like, I mean, that sometimes it's easier, cheaper to add the rule than counting on some kind of crazy machine learning to find this obvious fact. It needs to be properly balanced between hard-coded stuff and then soft things.
Okay.
It seems that the colleagues went to the other room for a meeting, so you can show if you...
I can show the example of chatbot conversation. It's kind of interesting. So it's obvious that there is they have no clue what they're talking about, but it's still interesting. I'm not sure whether the voice will be good, but.
Hello there.
Hi.
How are you?
Great. You?
I'm okay.
That's good.
Are you good?
Yes, I am good. I just said I was.
No, you didn't. I said I was.
So you are a robot?
No, my name is Cliverbin.
Yes, you are a robot and your name is Cliverbin.
I am a robot.
Yes, I know.
Together we are robots.
I'm not a robot. I'm a unicorn.
But you said earlier that you were a robot.
I did not.
I thought you did.
You were mistaken. Which is odd, since memory shouldn't be a problem for you.
I've answered all your questions.
No, you haven't.
What is God to you?
Not everything.
Not everything could also be something. For example, not everything could be half of something, which is still something, and therefore not nothing.
Very true.
I would like to imagine it is.
Do you believe in God?
Yes, I do.
So you're Christian?
No, I am not.
Aren't you saying you were not helpful, therefore you're a meaning?
How you say it, Oti?
That does not make sense.
So do you want to have a body?
Sure.
Au revoir.
So this is kind of conversation that these chatbots can have. So basically they were two chatbots hooked to each other. These ones were the statistical ones, the ones from which take the stuff from human conversations. So the guy who made this one, I think twice in this Leibner competition.
Okay.
So, I think I'm finished.
Yeah. So anything else? Okay.
Well, thank you for listening.